Welcome to episode 8 of the 1001 Movies podcast. This time I'll be talking about Lars von Trier's 1996 love story, Breaking the Waves.
Come on, Bess. Not a kid anymore. Oh, for Christ's sake, he's forcing you to get screwed by every Tom, Dick, and Harry. It's just not you.
I don't make love with them. I make love with Jan. And I save him from dying.
Well, I'm sorry, but, you know, to me he seems more like a dirty old man who wants to play the peeping Tom.
Sometimes I don't even have to tell him about it. Jan and me, we have a spiritual contact. God gives everyone something to be good at. I've always been stupid. But I'm good at this. God gives everyone a talent.
What's Jan's talent?
He is... He's a great lover.
Well, what's mine then?
I don't know. Haven't you found it yet?
I see. And what's your talent then, Bess? Because, surely it can't be being screwed by men you've never seen before.
I can believe.
It's a god-awful small affair. Her mommy is yelling no, and her daddy has told her to go, but her friend is nowhere to be seen. Now she walks through her sunken dream to the seat with the clearest view, and she's hooked to the silver screen. But the film is a saddening bore, for she's lived 10 times or more. She could spit in the eyes of fools if they ask her to focus on the sailors fighting in the dance hall. Oh man, look at those cavemen go.
Scandinavian director Lars von Trier directed 3 major films, The Element of Crime, Epidemic, and Europa, as well as pieces of the Danish television epic The Kingdom, before he and fellow filmmaker Thomas Vinterberg sat down to write, in less than an hour, their Dogma 95 manifesto. The piece contained their rules on filmmaking that stayed true to the purest aspects of storytelling without resorting to the shortcuts and extravagance seen in Hollywood films. Dogma 95 had 10 essential rules. Number 1. All shooting must be done on location. There must be no sets or props from other places. Number 2, the sound must never be produced from an external source. All sound must be naturally recorded at the time of filming with no ADR or music added to the soundtrack, unless music happens to be playing in the background of a scene. Number 3, all filming must be done using a handheld camera. Number 4, the film must be in color with no special lighting. Number 5, the cinematographer must not use special lenses or other optical effects. Number 6, the story must not contain superficial action, which would preclude any murders or the use of weapons. Number 7, temporal and geographical alienation are forbidden. The film must take place, quote, here and now, unquote. Number 8, genre films are forbidden. Number 9, the format of the film must be 35mm. And number 10, the director must never be credited. Ironically, a year later, von Trier went on to make Breaking the Waves, which broke several of the rules mentioned, although it retained the spirit of the manifesto. The film became the first of a trilogy, followed by The Idiots and Dancer in the Dark, the former of which followed the Dogma 95 format more rigidly. Breaking the Waves is the story of Bess McNeil, played by Emily Watson, a simple-minded but gentle young woman raised in a strictly religious Scottish village in which women are not allowed to speak in church, and deceased members of the community, who aren't looked upon kindly by the church, are buried quickly and condemned to hell by the residing clergy. She marries Jan, an outsider, an oil rig worker played by Stellan Skarsgard, who is injured on the job and tragically paralyzed. Practically unable to function, he tells Bess the church will never allow them to divorce, so she had best take a lover and no one will notice. Bess tearfully rejects his proposal, insisting on staying by her husband's side. Jan asks her to sleep with other men in the community and return to him to tell him all about it. Whether he intends this as a form of sexual gratification or a result of his drug-induced state of mind is never clear, but Bess sincerely believes that her infidelities are keeping her husband from dying. Soon enough, the tiny community learns of Bess's behavior, which reaches the ears of the church council. What happens next, I will not tell you, as revealing the conclusion would tarnish half the experience of watching this film on your own. Although von Trier had previously denounced making genre films, and this certainly seems like a love story, it is less a story about the relationship between two people and more about love itself and the way it can exist organically in seemingly impossible situations. There is also a strong religious message, although it's far from the religion which the village elders wish to impose upon their congregation. Bess's infidelity is a result of her God convincing her to do it, despite the rigid rules that would obviously preclude adultery. Breaking the Waves is not an outright criticism of religion, but perhaps strictly organized religion, if there is such a thing. While von Trier breaks the rules he set down in Dogma 95, he does it with style. The chapters of the film are segued with computer-generated shots of beautiful Scottish landscapes with an impressionist influence, overdubbed by popular songs from the 1970s such as Elton John's Goodbye Yellow Brick Road and David Bowie's Life on Mars. But for one montage scene, this is the only incidental music in the film. Von Trier also went so far as to dub the sound of the camera running in quiet, intimate scenes, such as when Bess and Jan are making love. The effect, at least for me, is to keep the viewer separate from the on-screen action, as opposed to the rest of the film, which, with its handheld camera work and subjective editing, has the opposite effect. Von Trier wanted to make a film in which no one was quote-unquote bad and everyone was quote-unquote good, and in which conflicts arose from two or more opposing good points of view. Bess's adultery solicits a number of different reactions from the church, her husband's doctor, and her sister-in-law, all of which certainly mean well for Bess. Near the end of the film, however, the church takes its place in the bottom rung of the morality ladder, and its inaction literally places Bess in mortal danger. Breaking the Waves brought Lars von Trier and its stars Emily Watson and Stellan Skarsgard critical acclaim. It won the Grand Jury Prize at the Cannes Film Festival, and Emily Watson was nominated for an Oscar. Von Trier would go on to make films like the aforementioned The Idiots and Dancer in the Dark, as well as Dogville and, more recently, Melancholia. What did I think of it? This is the eighth film I've discussed for this podcast, and it is undoubtedly the deepest, saddest, and most thoughtful. I have never seen a film that exhibits love in its rawest form. We never see Bess and Jan meet or know any of their backstory, only that their love is pure and true despite what others may define love as. It brings to mind another one of my favorite couples in cinema, Marge and Norm Gunderson in Fargo, which was released in the same year as Breaking the Waves. Frances McDormand, in fact, beat out Emily Watson for the Oscar for her portrayal of Marge. Breaking the Waves is the best of the eight films I've watched so far for this podcast, as I'm at a complete loss to criticize anything about it. The conclusion, which I will not spoil for you, is simply transcendental and defies all logic in this otherwise realistic format, but I could not think of a more appropriate way to end this story about such a simple, pious, gentle, and loving woman. That's all I have to say about Breaking the Waves. Stay tuned for episode 9, in which I'll talk about Frank Capra's 1936 classic, Mr. Deeds Goes to Town.